The Sony MZ-RH910 is another Sony high-MD portable recorder similar to the MZ-RH10. I've never had one, so I was excited to find one on eBay, though it does have a flaw. The USB port has a sliding cover, and it has the same jog wheel like the MZ-RH10, but instead of an OLED, it uses a simple LCD. In this video, we'll open it up and lube it since these old things need maintenance to keep going. There are some visible screws, but also one hiding under this eject slider. And others under this battery door. Oops. Remember when I said this one had a flaw? The previous owner used a twisted up piece of wire to make the battery contact, but we'll address that later. Let's start with the two under the battery door. Then we'll get the rear edge. And finally, the one under the eject slider. Just hold it with your finger while unscrewing. It's recommended to leave the USB port cover open, so let's do that. I'm going to start with some picks or spudgers on the back edge. Be careful around this middle area since you can see part of the right head cable. We'll want to get the case over the charging contacts for the sidecar. Be gentle. If no luck, let's get another pick in there. I'm going to try to open it opposite of the headphone jack side. I'm going to get a pick in here to help me separate. Okay, making some progress. There. Now we're going to want to open this like a book, gently, towards the headphone jack side. There's a ridge around the jacks, so if it doesn't lift out, we can use a pick to get some room. And that should do it. Remove it gently, especially along the back edge where that pick was. You can see the right cable there. It's thin and delicate, so be careful around it. It's pretty clean in here. Take note of the hold switch since we need that to be in the right place when reassembling. Here's another key piece to look out for. This spring provides tension to open the door. Take note of the position so we can put it back in properly. Let's go ahead and get the lid off. Just a few screws. These screws are different, so please keep track of them in a separate area. Since the front panel has a display, there's a ribbon cable we'll have to carefully remove. Using tweezers, gently slide the ends of the brown tabs away, and then the cable can be pulled out gently. Once that's done, we can hinge the lid off. There were no screws on this side, just a plastic arm hooked onto the MD tray. And there goes the spring. Keep track of that. Looks pretty clean overall. Usually there's a lot of dust, lint, or hair inside. This one's not bad at all. Okay, so let's do a bit of cleaning with isopropyl alcohol. We'll use a cotton swab and clean the old lube off the gearshaft and laser sled rail. Plenty of space here, so just reach in gently and clean off the white stuff you see on the gearshaft. You can go in here under the MD tray also. While you're in here, clean up any miscellaneous dust or lint you see, but this one is pretty clean overall. Okay, now we use some white lithium grease to lube the gearshaft and laser sled rail. For this, I'm using a non-cotton tip swab and just a dab of grease. Just reach in and carefully apply it to the gear shaft. You can get it into the grooves or threads. By flipping it this way, I can get some on the other side of the laser sled. It's just a flat rail that the laser sled slides along. Now, let's push the sled over to the far side so that when it powers on again, it will work the lube into the gear shaft. Just a bit more lube on the gear shaft and sled rail. Whatever you can reach. If you accidentally get some white lithium grease in spots you didn't intend to, just wipe them off with a bit of isopropyl alcohol. Let's get the laser sled rail on this side too. In this case, I need to do a bit of cleanup, so I'll get some isopropyl alcohol on a swab and tidy up. It can be a bit tight to work in there, so if you get grease on the ribbon cable, just clean it off with alcohol. Okay, so let's get this put back together. Remember, this side has the spring which we need to get aligned first, so let's focus on that. The spring has a long end and a short end. Line up the shorter end into the tab by the hole, and let the coiled part sit on the tab by the hole. I'll hold the coiled part in place with my thumb, and you can see the longer arm up top where it will meet the lid. Continue to hold the coiled part on the tab, since we're going to put the lid on and align that longer arm into a groove. Here's that groove that the longer spring arm will fit into. I dropped the spring, so let's try this again. Let's get the shorter arm tucked in, then put the coil onto the tab by the hole. It's fine if the long arm is sitting up like this. For now, we can tuck it under this metal tab. As we lower the lid, we need to get the plastic arm around the MD tray and get this long arm of the spring into the groove of the lid. We'll need to get the hole aligned with that peg by my thumbs, but first, let's get the lid hooked on properly. Let's take a look at that plastic arm that needs to hook around the MD tray. It's got just a bit of a hook on it, and we need to get that under the MD tray. Lift up the MD tray and hook the lid's arm under it. If you're lucky, the long arm of the spring fell into the groove of the lid. If not, use your fingernail or tweezers to lift it and get it into the groove on the lid. There. Now it's in. But the plastic arm may have unhooked from the MD tray. It's easy enough to push back into place. Okay, plastic arm and spring look good. Let's make sure the bottom peg is aligned with the hole at the hinge. Here, you can see the spring's coil is sitting securely on the metal tab, and the long arm is in the plastic groove of the lid. The short arm is hooked under this small tab, so everything looks correct. Let's flip it around and get this screwed back in. Remember, these screws were different, so I hope you kept them separate. Let's double check to ensure everything is good on this side. Okay, looks good. Let's get ready to reassemble by tucking in the battery door contact. In this case, it's just a wire. As usual, we'll start jack side first and keep an eye on the hold switch since it can slide around. Hang on to the hold switch while assembling to keep it in the right place. Eject slider's working, so let's proceed. Gently push everything back down into the lower casing. Double checking the hold switch. If it's stuck, you may need to lift everything back out and start over. Everything looks good, so let's get this thing screwed back together. just the obvious screws and then the ones inside the battery door and under the eject slider. And there you have it, but let's test it out. I'm going to have to fix this battery door properly in a later video. I think I can scavenge a piece from another dead Sony. For now, let's get this battery door back on and see if it's all working again. There we go. I know it's not as fancy as an OLED, but at least it didn't have lifespan issues like the original Sony MZ-RH10. There are replacement displays for the Sony MZ-RH10 that I plan to feature in a future video, though. This jog dial is nice, so I can't wait to get a replacement screen in my Sony MZ-RH10. It's not as easy to find these Sony high-MD portables at affordable prices these days, but if you happen to find a Sony MZ-RH910, they're great units that can play and record anything. They also happen to look pretty good and have a sweet jog dial, just like the MZ-RH10. Looking forward to replacing the screen in my Sony MZ-RH10 soon. As always, thanks for watching.